What makes Paul Gascoigne such a special and iconic sports star?
He was a one-off. He had a skill that you couldn't teach. He had an appetite that you couldn't teach. He broke the rules. The public loved him. His fellow pros loved him. And I've not seen a player with such natural skill playing for England ever. There are players who have dedicated themselves and made themselves better players. But Paul Gascoigne was just a... If there is a natural in sport, Paul Gascoigne was one of those.
Paul is responsible for some of the finest moments of football ever seen on the pitch. Is there one in particular that is the most precious to you personally?
It's an interesting question, and a lot of people would go for the semi-final goal at Wembley that he smashed in. I go for a particular moment in the World Cup, which I was covering with ITV in 1990 in Sardinia, when England played Holland, and he pulled off the most amazing Cruyff turn against the Dutch, and the defender didn't know what was going on, and Gazza did that, and I thought, well, if you're good enough to do that against the Dutch, you are one special player. And in 1990, I really don't think there was anyone better in that World Cup than Paul Gascoigne. I really don't.
We all love the glory of Paul on the pitch, but I think this in particular is a documentary that explores the darkness that followed Paul off the pitch. Can you talk a little bit about whether or not you think it is perhaps timely for us to be exploring and dissecting the sometimes toxic relationship, particularly between the media and our sport and sporting stars?
It's a very interesting question. It's a question, the media relationship with top sportsmen, that I could bore you about for a very long time. Thank goodness there was no real social media around when Gazza was playing, by the way, that mobile phones were in their infancy, and there were no websites, etc., etc., and forums. But he suffered from it, of course he did. But for me, he was comfy playing with the white lines around him. When he came off that pitch, he got problems, really. And I haven't seen the movie yet. I'm looking forward to seeing it. But there's no point in pretending that he has had a lot of struggles and continues to have in his life. And I feel really, really sorry for him in that respect. These days, he might have get better looked after earlier. But a lot of people have tried very, very hard to look after Gazza, and it's a very tough task. So I hope he's in a decent place at the moment. But he's not the first, and he won't be the last, of an absolutely amazing sportsman who, when the lights go out, has suffered.
There's a big discussion going on at the moment about looking after our clubs in terms of ownership and the fit and proper purpose test and how well that has or hasn't been applied. Do you have any particular feelings about that issue and the way in which we're now seemingly overnight changing our perspective on it?
Well, we're talking about Premier League clubs here, aren't we? So, I mean, the vast majority of clubs this doesn't apply to. But the downside of overseas ownership is coming graphically into the headlines now. And anyone who thought, oh, these nice Chinese owners, American owners, owners from the UAE are just coming in to help English football, are now getting their answer. They're not coming to help English clubs. They're coming into it for themselves. And it's now, we are where we are, and it's going to be a very, very difficult thing to turn around. And by the way, that fit and proper persons test that you mentioned, I don't understand it. I don't understand how you can pass it. I don't understand how you can fail it, if I'm honest. So we're now really seeing the end results of clubs chasing money and then paying the price for it.
More positive note, obviously we're heading into a championship period, both of the Lionesses and the men's team. How are you feeling about our chances of that, given the obviously luminous performance in recent times?
Well, I hope we do well. I really hope we do well. Don't get me on about why the World Cup is being played in Qatar, because that's another very contentious subject. And we've done exceedingly well. We've reached a semi and we've reached a final, and I hope we go one step better than that. But there are some very, very good teams in World Cups, and unless I've missed something, we haven't won one since 1966. So it's going to be very, very tough. But I've always been an England fan, always will be, like everybody out there. And goodness me, it'd be great if, what a Christmas present that would be, wouldn't it, if they won that World Cup final.